Hey guys, today we'll discuss about corticosteroids pharmacology. So before going to corticosteroids pharmacology, so steroids are produced in our body. Where exactly? In our adrenal gland, right? So they have some functions, they have their own importance, and we have some drugs which are artificially prepared in the, you know, outside. So let's discuss first about the classification, then we'll go to steroids step by steps. So first we'll start with the classification. These drugs are classified into three groups according to their duration of action. So we have short acting, intermediate acting and long acting drugs. Short acting drugs include cortisone, hydrocortisone, and intermediate drugs includes prednisolone, methylprednisolone, prednisone, budesonide, and long acting drugs includes dexamethasone, paramethasone, betamethasone. So they classified according to the duration of their action, right? So now we'll discuss where exactly these steroids are produced in our body and what is their importance and what is the importance of these drugs that are prepared artificially. So we'll start where they are produced. So in our body, they're produced in adrenal gland. Where in adrenal gland? In the adrenal cortex. So in the adrenal cortex, they're produced. In adrenal cortex, we have some area called zona fasciculata. So from that area, these corticosteroids are produced. So the corticosteroid, principal corticosteroid which is produced in our body is cortisol. Right. So this is a principal steroid which is produced in our body, but they made to, like, you know, they prepared artificial preparations. So we'll discuss what is the action of these corticosteroids. So before going to that, we'll discuss small important topic, that is a important concept, when it is when it is produced in a daily basis, in a diurnal rhythm. These cortisol produced in the early morning, every early morning the cortisol is produced according to our requirement. Further, there is a small peak of production, but peak quantity is produced in the early morning. So now what happens, this cortisol and artificially produced drugs, whenever we introduce into a person, what will happen, right? So they have an effect on the glucose metabolism. What they will do, they will cause gluconeogenesis. So they will increase gluconeogenesis. How they will increase gluconeogenesis? What do we understand by this term gluconeogenesis? Gluconeogenesis, which means the glucose is produced from a non-carbohydrate source. So from whom they are produced? From amino acids. So whenever glucocorticoids are in a body, what they will do? They will increase gluconeogenesis, right? And what else they will do? They will increase the blood pressure, right? So for example, let's take a condition. We have a stress, We have stress. So what we need? We need more energy. That is provided by gluconeogenesis. So they are important during stress as well. And these drugs, they have an anti-inflammatory property. So how they are anti-inflammatory actions, we'll discuss that now, right? So what happens during the inflammation? We have externally we have some damage. So whenever there is a damage, what will happen? There is an enzyme called phospholipidase A2. Phospholipidase A2 is stimulated. When phospholipidase A2 is stimulated, our cell membranes are made up of what? So they are made up of phospholipids, right? So what will happen? These phospholipidase will act on the phospholipids. When it acts on the phospholipids, what will happen? It will produce a compound called arachidonic acid. Right? So this arachidonic acid has two fates. What can happen? It can enter into one pathway called LOX pathway. So there is another group of drugs which deal with LOX pathway. It can enter to other one more pathway called COX pathway. So the drugs which deal with COX pathway are non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. I already have a video on that. You can check it out. So where exactly these corticosteroids act, they will inhibit this phospholipidase A2. So whenever there is an inhibition of phospholipidase A2, so there is no production of arachidonic acid. If there is no production of arachidonic acid, there is no further inflammation continues. Along with the inhibition of phospholipidase A2, we have other anti-inflammatory properties. So what they will do? So let's take a condition. You have a damage on your hand, right? So what will happen? Whenever there is a damage, whenever there is an inflammation, all white blood cells, whatever in your body, in a circulation, they will come to site of injury and they will increase the inflammation. So whenever I put corticosteroids into you, what will happen? They will redistribute the cells. So they will redistribute whom? They will redistribute WBCs. And they will redistribute also whom? Eosinophils. Eosinophils and also basophils. So whenever there is a redistribution of these cells, where they are redistributed means they are diverted from circulation to somewhere else. So where they are diverted, this redistribution happens to lymphoid tissues. So lymphoid tissues such as lymph nodes maybe, for example. So when they are redistributed, you don't have enough circulating macrophages, for example, circulating white blood cells, eosinophils. So these are involved during our allergic reaction, right? So we know that one property now, we can be used during allergy. And WBCs, so we can use it during inflammation, right? So they are redistributed to lymphocytes. So we know they increase blood pressure, they increase glucose, and also they have one important role. They are required everywhere in our body, like almost all metabolisms, but they don't directly involve in the metabolism. They just require their presence to happen some metabolism, right? So now, apart from this, if I put artificial corticosteroids or if I increase cortisol, what will happen? They will have one more property. They will redistribute your fat. Means what they will do, whatever fats present in our body in the periphery, they will put it to the central regions. So that will produce something like Cushing's habitus. That is Cushing habitus. So Cushing habitus includes buffalo hump, right? So buffalo hump is nothing but there is a bump of fat on your neck, right? Along with that, they will cause hirsutism. Hirsutism is an increased hair growth, right? So this is a effect of steroids on our body, right? So we'll see now uses. So before going to uses, what we should understand, how they are given, right? So we'll see how they are, like, you know, what are the possible routes of administration for the corticosteroids. So corticosteroids can be given intravenously, intramuscularly, orally, you know, locally. What do I mean by locally? So for example, locally means you have some injury. For example, you have an inflammation on your skin. So I can use corticosteroids for a local application, means that is topical application. I can use it for eye drops, for example. And also we have another route, inhalation route. Right. So they are well absorbed in our GAT as well. So when they are absorbed, what will happen? Then go and bind with plasma proteins, right? So they will bind with plasma proteins. What will happen? They are transported to liver for metabolism. So there, microsomal, like, you know, microsomal enzymes, it undergoes oxidation with the enzymes and it forms its own metabolites and they are excreted by kidney, right? So we know how drug enters. And now we know how drug excreted out of the body. So we'll discuss the uses now. We already know many uses. They are almost used in many places, right? So we'll start from one by one. So we know some property called anti-inflammatory. So can I use it in all inflammations? Right. Inflammatory conditions such as rheumatoid arthritis, right? Osteoarthritis. Where else we can use? We can use it in autoimmune disease. Right. Where else we can use? So these drugs also can be used whenever, like, you know, we need to, for example, there is a premature labor happening. So what will happen if there is a premature labor happening? So the fetal lung is not completely matured. Whenever there is no fetal lung maturation, we will use, you know, external corticosteroids for fetal lung maturation. Where else we can use? We can use it in allergic conditions. So allergic conditions, where we can use? In bronchial asthma, right? So if I am telling bronchial asthma, how should I use it? So in a inhalating route. Where else we can use? Skin allergies, right? Why? Because they have a property of anti-inflammation. Where else we can use? Wherever there is a stress conditions, for example, you know, we can use it for a patient with brain trauma. He has a severe stress. We can use it, right? So during stress conditions. And also, where else we can use? For example, everywhere, every day there are transplantations going on, right? So whenever transplantation occurs of a, for example, let's take kidney. So we have transplanted a kidney. After transplantation, there can be organ rejection. So to avoid that organ rejection, can we suppress our immune system? Right. So we'll suppress our immune system and we can use it during when, for example, so for transplantation rejection. Mean during transplantations. Right. Where else we can use? Apart from this, I was telling it is produced from adrenal gland. Where in the adrenal gland? From the adrenal cortex. So we have a disease called Addison's disease where there is no production of steroids takes place. So we can use it during Addison's disease. Right. And also we will use it in the diagnosis of Cushing's disease. For example, who is stimulating our pituitary gland? So pituitary gland is stimulated by a hormone called ACTH, right? So if it is stimulated by ACTH, we have some problem with pituitary and my ACTH is not produced. So what we should do? We should give corticosteroids because there is no stimulation of adrenal gland and there is no cortisol formation. So we can use it during decreased ACTH production. So we have noted some uses. Apart from these corticosteroids, whenever I put into a body, what will happen? It has some effect on pituitary. So let's see how, you know, it has effect on the pituitary gland. So we have a gland called pituitary gland. So pituitary gland is having two areas. One is anterior pituitary, one is posterior pituitary. So ACTH is produced from the anterior pituitary, right? So this ACTH, whatever is produced, it will go and stimulate whom? It will go and stimulate adrenal gland, right? So whenever it acts on the adrenal gland, what will happen? It will produce cortisol, right? So this is cortisol is a naturally occurring. But in place of cortisol, we are giving our artificial drugs. So they have a similar effect on the pituitary. What they will do? It will go and inhibit pituitary gland. What it will do? Now, you know, I have enough cortisol in my body. So don't produce more ACTH. This is called a negative feedback mechanism. Negative feedback mechanism. Right. So if I'm using cortisol, means instead of cortisol, if I'm using corticosteroids for a longer period of time, so continuously ACTH is inhibited. So if continuously ACTH is inhibited, if I stop the drugs, whatever I'm taking every day, if I stop the drugs at once, what will happen? So I will have adrenal crisis. So that is acute insufficiency of the adrenal gland because of lack of ACTH, right? So these are some uses of corticosteroids. Right, so we'll discuss the side effects. So we know side effects already, many of them. What it will do? It was increasing glucose levels, so it will cause hyperglycemia, right? So if it causing hyperglycemia, where it is contraindicated or where it should be, you know, where the dose management should be done in diabetes mellitus, right? So what else it will cause? It was increasing blood pressure, right? So if it is increasing blood pressure, it is also contraindicated during hypertension, right? So whenever we give corticosteroids to a person, what will happen? It will, you know, impair the calcium absorption in the intestine, then it will cause osteoporosis. Osteoporosis. Right. So to avoid this osteoporosis, so we can advise the patient to take vitamin D and calcium preparations. Right. So we advise the patient to take calcium and vitamin preparation if at all we should use it for a longer period of time. So apart from this, it will cause something called, if you stop all of a sudden, it will cause adrenal crisis, that is Addison's crisis. So what else it will cause? It was suppressing our immune system, right? So if our immune system is suppressed, what will happen? We are more prone to infections. Right. So these are some side effects of corticosteroids, and they have more side effects, such as this cortisol is very important for regulation of our GFR. So that is glomerular filtration rate. So, you know, if there is some impairment or if there is some abnormality with the cortisol levels, so that can lead to abnormal function of kidney as well, and they have an effect on the eye, such as it can cause glaucoma, and they can also cause cataract. So earlier I told, during mechanism of anti-inflammatory property of corticosteroids, that they inhibit phospholipidase A2 and decrease the production of arachidonic acid. So arachidonic acid is one of the important substance to produce some prostaglandins, which are important for our stomach, means mucosal reproduction. So if mucosa is not regrowing properly, that may lead to peptic ulcers. So it may cause ulcers also. So these are some side effects of the corticosteroids. Keep following. Thank you, guys.